Hello, my name is Amanda Gevens, Extension Plant Pathologist at the University of Wisconsin. I work in potatoes and vegetables. This morning I'll be talking to you all about tomato late blight. Late blight has come to the state of Wisconsin at the end of July. We had our first report on tomatoes in Dane County on July 29th, and since then we've had numerous reports from home gardeners to commercial production, organic production throughout the state of Wisconsin, with the concentration in the southern tier. Symptoms of tomato late blight include a foliar stage, which begin as a pale green to deep green lesion on the leaves. And the lesions often look water-soaked or wet. Some people describe them as greasy. These lesions, when they begin to dry up, will turn brown, and the leaves get somewhat crispy. Basically, it's just dead leaf tissue. If you turn the leaves over, oftentimes you can find white fuzzy growth, and this is the sporulation of the pathogen, the Phytophthora infestans pathogen, which causes late blight. In addition to lesions on leaves, we can also see stem lesions. And here we have five very nice characteristic stem lesions. They're dark brown in color. They can turn almost a dark black color. It looks somewhat sooty, somewhat oily on the stems. And oftentimes, if you look at these early in the morning, when there's some leaf wetness and some humidity, or higher moisture in the air, you can see the pathogen sporulating right on these stem lesions, and it will look white and fuzzy. As we can see here, we've got some very distinctive and characteristic symptoms of late blight fruit rot. And the fruit rot often begins right along the stem end or the shoulders of the tomato. The shoulders are the area right along the crown or crest of the tomato fruit. And it occurs there because as the leaves produce new spores, they're washed down into the lower canopy, often where the fruit are located, and the spores can lodge in around the stem or any cracks or creases in the fruit, and that's where it will make an infection. Both green fruit can become infected with the late blight pathogen and ripened fruit. In this case here, there's a symptom of fruit infection on a ripe fruit. It looks a little bit different, but most distinctive has to do with the texture of the lesion. If you were to feel this, it's a firm rot. It's brown and somewhat sunken, but it stays hard. As that lesion develops, oftentimes the skin will crack. And when there's a crack or a wound in the skin, we get secondary bacterial pathogens and organisms enter into that wound, and that's when it begins to develop a soft rot. So the late blight pathogen itself is not a soft rotter, but it is the damage to the tissue which brings in secondary bacteria which causes that soft rot. Fruit that do have infections such as these should be culled out. You know, there's very little left on this tomato to possibly eat anyhow once you were to remove any of the lesions. And it's advised that fruit that have lesions such as these not be used for canning. Reason being, once you have damaged skin and bacteria enter into the fruit, the bacteria themselves pose a threat in the canning process of tomatoes, and it impacts the pH of the tomato fruit, which can also result in some negative consequences when the fruit are canned. Now, late blight in the state of Wisconsin, as I mentioned earlier, has spread rapidly from Dane County throughout the southern tier and has moved northward in the state. At this time, we have 14 counties with positive reports of late blight on tomato. We have just 3 counties with positive reports of late blight on potato. And this disease, late blight, is most well known for the destruction it caused in the 1800s in a period of history known as the Irish potato famine. This pathogen, Phytophthora infestans, was responsible for that epidemic in potato. So we know that this can be a very aggressive pathogen, can be a very destructive plant disease. So on tomato was the first host in the state. After about 3 weeks, we determined that it was also on potato. Other potential hosts include plants such as peppers and eggplants. They're all in the same plant family, which is known as the Solanaceae. To date, the worst of the reports of late blight in the state have been on tomato, certainly all other solanaceous crops have the potential to become infected. There are some weed species that also serve as a host to Phytophthora infestans, and those are the nightshades. Hairy nightshade in particular can become infected with the late blight pathogen. And for that reason, weed management in a production field, even in a home garden, is important. So what can be done to manage late blight? At this stage in the game, the symptoms that we see here, there's no reversing of disease in this situation. The best advice we can give to whether it be a home gardener with 10 plants or a larger farm operation of thousands of plants is to harvest what fruit they can. To go in and harvest fruit as soon as they begin to have a blush of color, and we know they have the potential to ripen off the vine and be saleable. The application of fungicides when infection is this severe has been unsuccessful. But when we think about future years, or what could have been done in this year to prevent some of this crop loss, if protective fungicides go out in advance of a first infection, it can help protect the plant. And once you protect against that first infection, and you follow up with a spray program of something like copper or any range of other fungicides that have activity to manage and control late blight, you can limit that first infection. One of the final management aspects of controlling tomato late blight, whether it be in the home garden or a larger operation, is a plant destruction. And this should take place after you've harvested all the tomato fruit you wish off of the plant. And the goal of this process is truly to kill the plant. When you kill the plant, you're also killing the pathogen with it. The late blight pathogen requires living tissue to be viable and to survive. So we want to limit the risk of potentially creating a situation where we would allow the pathogen to overseason or overwinter. So the best approach is killing the plant. So how can you do that? Well, there are various methods. One of them is if you've got just a dozen plants or so, you could pull them up out of the ground, put them into a dark colored lawn and leaf bag, a plastic bag. If you keep that out in the sun for a few days, it will in effect solarize the plant tissue and kill it via a higher heat. And once the plant is dead, the pathogen is also dead. Another method, you can burn the plant foliage with a propane torch or some type of flame, and that will effectively kill the plant fairly quickly. Another approach that's been taken is applying herbicide or some type of defoliant to chemically kill the plant. That is effective. And a final approach is to basically to chop the plants at the lower stem. So you're separating the upper plant portion from the root, and that will allow the plant to die in place. It takes a little bit longer for the plant to die in that condition. So you are having a period of time where the plant is still living, respiring, and the pathogen is producing new spores. So that's a bit of a slower kill, but if you have a larger field, and it's one of your only options, in particular if you're an organic producer, that can be done. Once the plant material is dead, It's good to leave it on the surface of the soil and then to allow a good harsh winter kill this winter. That will ensure that all the plant material is dead. And once the plant is dead, again, the pathogen dies with it. In the following season, our risk of late blight is low. If we kill this plant, infected plant tissue, plant material at this time of the season. The pathogen itself cannot produce a spore that resides or stays in the soil over winter. It doesn't have the ability to do that. So once we kill the plant tissue, we kill the pathogen. And next season we should have much better luck in the absence of late blight. But there's no risk of it going into the soil and over-seasoning in that manner. If you'd like further information about tomato or potato late blight, please visit the Plant Pathology website. A simple search on University of Wisconsin Vegetable Pathology will take you to a website which offers various helpful links to management and identification of the pathogen.